Good afternoon, and welcome to the Your Town television program on AMP's Access Monterey Peninsula Cable Channel 24 and on the internet at ampmedia.org. Every weekday at 5 o'clock, we are proud to have as our guests various local civic and community leaders. The purpose of the program is to help inform listeners and viewers like you about some of the things going on in your town. And now, on with the program.
Hello and welcome to the Your Town television program. My name is Steve Ellzey. I'm the executive producer of Access Monterey Peninsula. I am here with you today as your host, and every second Monday you get to see me. We have a wonderful show laid out for you today, and let's get right to it. With me in the studio right now is Mr. Gerry Mackenzie, and his father and grandfather were involved with the motion picture industry right at the beginning, and this is going to be a fascinating interview. Gerry, welcome to Your Town.
Glad to be here.
Jim, if we could go to Mac 01, and I'm going to hand this over to you. Gerry, tell the folks at home what they're looking at on the screen.
Well, this is going way back. The magic lantern was introduced. This is the first time we were able to take a image and project it.
Okay.
And so it's this started out hand-painted glass images
would
go in there.
Mm-hmm.
And then photography came in, and they would have a film in there, and they would project it. So it was really the beginning of motion pictures, because it was the first time they were able to project an image.
To project, okay. And Jim, if you could bring up Mac 02, and Gerry, I'm going to show you this, and I'm just going to ask you, when they had these magic lanterns, they went to homes at first, but did this end up being mass entertainment eventually? Or?
Yeah, I don't know what size of the audience it would be. It'd probably be limited somewhat by the candle power of the.
Okay.
It initially started out, the light was from not a candle really, but from whale oil or benzene.
Okay.
And they brought in
limelight.
Limelight, yes.
Mm-hmm.
That's the expression being in the limelight started from that.
I bet there were very few people who knew that. And then, Jim, how about Mac 03? And we're going to, Gerry, I'm going to put this in front of you. Who is that gentleman?
That's my grandfather. That's Cinema John.
Cinema John Mackenzie. And he was the first motion picture photographer in
Scotland.
In Scotland.
Probably within the first dozen in the world.
Okay, and he made travel logs. Tell us what those were.
Well, he would travel around the world. Initially, with the magic lantern, he would. The photography was invented back in the 1820s, 30s,
mm-hmm.
And he was a very good still photographer.
Okay.
And so he would prepare the slides and show them in auditoriums in Scotland.
Mm-hmm.
And he did that for a number of years.
Mm-hmm.
And then he heard that there was an exposition in London.
Right.
With the Lumiere brothers showing a motion picture camera.
Oh, boy.
Something that was going to show motion, project motion, which they hadn't been able to do.
Okay.
So he went down there and tried to buy one.
Uh-huh.
And, of course, he couldn't do that. So he went home and built one himself. He built both a projector and a camera.
Well, how could he do that? Was he experienced in lenses?
He had been apprenticed as a watchmaker and, I also understand, a lens maker.
Okay.
Which is the heart of the photography. So I guess it wasn't that difficult for him to do it.
Oh, boy.
I've seen pictures of his camera, though. It's a monster.
Is it?
Yeah.
Okay. Hey, then he hooked up with a gentleman by the name of Charles Urban.
Charles Urban.
Urban, and he started making those travelogues, and I guess Urban said to him, "We're gonna shoot real things and real people," and they ended up in India. And Jim, could we go to Mach 04 and show the folks? Your grandfather ended up shooting the coronation, was it?
The coronation, yeah, of the royal family.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a big thing in India. They had tremendous crowds and
right.
ideal photography. And he shot that. And really, with Charles Urban, that was just the beginning of what they did. After that, he would go all over the world shooting. Not necessarily something that big, but
right.
interesting things. I was reading the other night in his book, there was this British battleship that went aground off one of the islands.
And mm-hmm.
back then, they had no way of getting it off the
ground. Okay.
So he took his camera and uh-huh. went and shot it as it is, and here are the water coming out of the windows.
I'll be doggone.
Yeah.
And that must have been fascinating to people because they hadn't really seen motion
right,
pictures
right.
before.
And that was what the way it was done. He was, though he did show his pictures in some pretty big places like Madison Square Garden.
Wow.
And in England, in London, he would show them and got
a Palladium.
Especially big crowds.
Okay, now then your father, I believe, came to the United States with your grandfather, at least that's what I was reading.
Yeah, my father was the oldest son.
Okay.
Of four uncles, of,
mm-hmm.
and incidentally, three of them became motion picture cameramen.
Boy,
only one stayed out. But yeah, my father learned the business through my grandfather,
okay.
and they traveled all over the world. And he
were they shooting for the Canadian Railroad or something?
Yeah,
at that point?
I looking through some of the old records, it looked like most of the things they were shooting were under contract for somebody that wanted to
okay.
show.
Mm-hmm. As opposed to making a motion picture
with actors and actresses and plot and so forth. That
okay.
didn't come until a little later. In fact, I don't think my grandfather ever participated in a real movie, as we would call it.
Oh, all right.
He did all his photography on travelogues and
pictures, then,
right,
in other
right.
words.
And even when my father was working, a lot of their work was for private concerns.
Okay.
I think the best known one was the one that showed that the Hormel hired him to show that the animals were really treated well. They weren't mistreated.
Boy.
I forget the author that wrote the book that said this was
Upton Sinclair wrote
yeah.
that. Okay, so then your father got into the Army, and for World War I, they told him that he could become a citizen if he would be a motion picture photographer for the Army.
For the Signal Corps of the Army, yeah.
Okay, all right.
They were just putting together units that would be able to. And he was assigned to Southern California, where the racetrack is now, Santa Anita, was where they put in the balloon school.
Oh, the balloons which they used
school,
back
yeah.
there for
and,
reconnaissance.
What
uh-huh.
you did, you got in the basket under the balloon and got up there, and here were the two forces in trenches, and you shot them.
Oh, well, be doggone.
Even by that time, I think trench warfare was on its way out.
Yes, yes. Thankfully, yeah, when they got the tanks, it started to go
yeah.
on its way out.
Yeah.
Now, Jim, if you could put up Mach 05, and Gerry, that is a picture of some people making a motion picture, and your dad's in there, correct?
Yeah, that was really my father told me on a couple occasions it was the best and the largest motion picture he had been in. It was the crisis.
Okay.
It was about the Civil War, and
mm-hmm.
it would be comparable to Gone with the Wind or some of the ones that we've made with in sound.
Okay.
And it was shot in Mississippi.
All right.
And they hired the Mississippi National Guard to be all the soldiers in the action.
I'll be darned.
And this shot here is kind of interesting because here's my father. He was number one cameraman, mm-hmm. and I don't know the name of the number two man,
mm-hmm.
but the third one here, Mickey Nealon,
mm-hmm.
wasn't a cameraman at all. He was an actor.
Oh!
But I guess they needed three cameras to film the battle down there. So
sure.
He grabbed a camera. And
and the other cameraman was standing behind them taking this picture, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, it was a still.
I see.
I don't think it was a motion picture.
Okay. Now, then, your father worked for Selig, who built a studio in Chicago.
Chicago, yeah.
And
all the major studios were in the East Coast.
Okay. And this was in
New York,
previous to the 20s, right?
Yeah.
And then Mr. Selig supposedly came out to, well, he would come out to L.A., he liked the weather, he could shoot in the daytime. And if we could go to Mac 06, we have a fascinating picture here. This is your father actually shooting a motion picture down at the Selig Studios on the back lot.
Mm-hmm.
And,
yeah.
and tell us.
You can tell that because there's no roof.
There's no roof.
I've got similar pictures of the studio in Chicago,
okay.
and it's all glass.
Okay, and they could shoot down there with no roof because of the
sun was out most of the time. I guess they're in a rain where they just closed shop.
Yeah, and then the reason that they could do this and have sets next to each other was because it was...
It was the sound pictures they were shooting there,
okay.
and they could be doing a... telling people what to do over next door, and it wouldn't show up on the picture they were taking.
So you could have two or three sets laid next to
each other, all going at the same time.
Because it was silent films.
Yeah.
Oh, that's amazing. Now, if we could go to, I think it's Mac 07, this is a picture of your father, and I don't know, it looks to me like Southern California, but you tell us about it.
Well, he was shooting a Western. They were, Selig was shooting an awful lot of Westerns in those days.
Oh.
And that meant they had the outdoor, they didn't have to worry about lighting and things like that. They had the sunshine.
Uh-huh.
And when I first saw this, I said it looked an awful lot like Glendale, part of Glendale I've seen from Mount Verdugo looking out over Burbank.
Uh-huh.
And I think that's what it is. Now they, this one had a real Indian in it,
mm-hmm.
and Selig made a lot of Westerns, and most of the time he claimed to always use Indians, but I know other pictures we've seen there were actors that were
sure
being the Indians.
Sure, absolutely.
Yeah, I think the reason the Westerns were so popular was they didn't need that much sound.
Oh.
You know, they weren't conversing.
Right.
There wasn't much dialogue going on. There was just action.
Okay.
Jumping on the horse.
Right.
Racing across the screen, you know.
Mm-hmm. The gunfights.
Yeah. All that. So that's why the Western was so popular and big in those days. Yeah, no question about it.
Now, did your father make serials, the old serials that they'd show in the theater?
Yeah.
Show?
Initially, just about any theater that was showing a major film would have what they called two-reelers.
Oh, okay.
They were small comedies or something like that,
uh-huh.
on two reels.
Okay.
I don't know exactly how long that is, 30 minutes or something.
Okay.
While they were making the major, showing the major film.
Okay.
And then
let's go to the next one then, Jim, which is, I think, Mac 08, maybe. I'm getting my numbers confused, but is that Mac 08? That's another silent film studio there. And how long did your dad work for Selig?
He worked for Selig until... 1930, roughly.
Okay, so...
Which was just as sound had been coming in, and it really most of the work he did with Selig was silence.
Was silent, uh-huh.
And silent cameraman, and then when sound came in, he went to work for Technicolor.
Okay.
And Technicolor had a very interesting story in itself, in that
tell
it
us
was...
About that.
developed by two professors from MIT.
Okay.
And they built a studio in Hollywood. Well, I call it a studio, but actually all I did was build the cameras there and process the film that it shot.
Oh.
And it went through a number of years of losing money, and they had troubles. And when my father finally started working for them, they had finally developed about the fifth camera. And this was the three-color camera that used three negatives to take care of the fact that color is made up of a mixture of any of the three primary colors.
Sure, sure.
So this big camera, it was a big one, had three negatives going through an image that was that the lens would take and run it through a prism.
Okay.
So that each film got the identical. Then it would be sent back to the lab, and they would combine it on a single film. And that was the film then that they would duplicate and send out to all the movies.
Now, so there were actually three reels of film?
Film, yeah.
In each camera?
Yeah.
Okay, and then what about, I mean, did the projector have three reels in it, or how did they
do
that?
No, by the time this all happened in the studio, after you finished shooting it, they had what they call a rushes.
Oh, okay.
Which is looking to see what they did during the day at night.
The dailies,
Well, they would take the negatives out of the camera, send it over to the lab, which is in the same building, be developed and put together on a single film and sent back to my father, for instance, and they would review it, see what they shot.
Okay, so the three reels then were developed under one negative.
Yeah.
Oh, boy. Well, no wonder they had to be from MIT to figure out how to do that.
The interesting thing was that he hired nothing but, he wanted to hire nothing but graduate engineers from, so all the cameramen that came after my father were from Caltech.
I'll be darned. I wonder why that was. I'm not even going to speculate why that was. You know, what do you think?
Well, he was a professor at MIT. He was used to the engineering mind, I guess, and so he wanted somebody. See, their business was just shooting the pictures and developing and processing them.
They did
nothing else.
They didn't
have any directors. They didn't have any
actors or...
No, right.
So, now Technicolor then... If you were going to do a film in Technicolor, most of the studios would hire the camera and the camera operator, right? I mean, that's what you got when you did something in Technicolor.
Somebody at MGM, for instance, would decide, here's a good book, let's make it. They'd hire somebody to write it up, you know. They'd have their own director, their own producer, and they would make the contract with Technicolor, and Technicolor would send out the cameras and the crew, the cameraman.
Okay.
And Natalie Kalmus, the boss's wife, was the color coordinator.
Little nepotism.
And that was the group, and they had a contract with the Technicolor to do that.
Mm-hmm.
And it worked fairly well because there were competitors, there were other companies that were making color films, but they couldn't equal a Technicolor.
It was said to be the best, and they lasted for a long time, didn't they?
They lasted until video was put on with...
until digital video?
Digital came in.
Oh, okay. And now, Jim, I don't know if you can go back to Mac 09, but I've got to get this picture on there. there. Okay, now... Tell us who that is.
That's Tom Mix.
Tom Mix, and did you ever watch a Tom Mix movie?
I doubt it, because I only saw one or two silent films
in
my time.
Okay.
Yeah, well, but Tom Mix, of course, I believe he did both.
Oh, okay. Very famous cowboy, though. I mean, before John Wayne,
and he really did his own work.
His own stunts and everything, right?
Yeah.
Well, he was my dad's favorite, and my dad used to always say, well, I'm going to go see a Tom Mix, the new Tom Mix movie. It's called Cement, you know, Tom Mix in Cement.
Cement.
But anyway, I don't know, Gerry. That was a terrible joke. Are you a photographer also then, or do you watch photography?
I used to do a lot of still photography.
Okay.
And once in a while I would take movies with a little 8mm camera, but I wouldn't call myself a photographer.
Okay. Thank you so much for being on. I really appreciate it, Gerry. We'll have you back some other time. Okay. And we are going to go to a quick break. We will be back, though. This is the Your Town Television Program.
A moment with more of the Your Town Television Program here on AMP's Cable Channel 24 and on the internet at ampmedia.org. Just a moment with more of the Your Town Television Program here on AMP's Cable Channel 24 and on the internet at ampmedia.org.
Television Program. My name is Steve Ellzey. I'm the executive producer for Access Monterey Peninsula and your host. Today and every second Monday of the month, we've got another great guest with us. Michael Houston is in the studio here with me, and he is with Caminos del Arte and also with
Voices of the Street.
Voices of the Street.
Voces de la Calle.
Voces de la Calle is what I was trying to come up with.
This is our homeless paper here in Monterey County.
You know, that is really something, Michael. And Jim, could you go to Alisal 01 and 02? Because I wanted to ask you a little bit about the Alisal Center for Fine Arts, which you were with before.
Wonderful organization.
And they do wonderful things out there, including a First Friday Art Walk. Still, is that still going on?
They've been active in the with the collaborative. The groups in East Salinas really work together with the groups downtown and all of Salinas. So they exist to train kids to do art.
Okay.
And so if you're going to rehearse, for example, with the Ellisol percussion, you need places to perform. So they're very active in the different festivals that come around.
Oh, I see.
Be it, you know, opportunities to perform at the National Steinbeck Center, or collaborate with the Days of the Dead or the UNO Youth Festival or any number of the events that you see all up and down the valley in the region, because they're training kids and they're putting on events with Bakhtun 12, these wonderful theatrical groups that that are turning out the next generation of performing artists on stage, and then the other set that are performers in the dance world with the folk groups. You have Ramon Silva and Tonatua. They're just a fantastic organization.
And you have been you've been working. Tell us about Caminos del Arte. What does that organization do then?
Caminos del Arte is a similar training group to the Ellisol Center for the Fine Arts. These are both just wonderful organizations to me. These kind of organizations are like yak. You know, you can't have enough of these concessions that get young people art training. And so Caminos del Arte and Ellisol Center for the Fine Art go back decades, and they've been bringing shows to the community, doing after-school arts programs for young people. They've worked with incredible, talented collaborators. Ramon Silva, world-class folklorico dancer who out of Ellisol High and is a genius, is one. Jose Ortiz, the muralist, who has done fantastic pieces for Natividad Hospital. And these are regional superstars that are giving back to their community and passing their skills and their professionalism to a new generations. And you also have just amazing people like Armando Sarabia, a guitar teacher from Michoacán, Mexico, who spent the last 18 years teaching every generation to play guitar in ensemble. So these are places that they create the arts and they make art part of everyone's life, and especially the people who learn the discipline to it all.
We are so fortunate to have so much talent, rich artistic talent in the area. And let's talk a little bit about the core project here that you're working with, the Voces de la Calle, or Voices of the Street. Jim, if we could go to Houston 01 and 02, how did this newspaper start? Tell us about the paper.
Well, I believe it comes out of a tradition back in the 70s, or earlier still, if you want, with the old labor unions, you know, when working for working people and poor people's paper. But really, it goes back, these street papers go back to the 70s. And we were very fortunate to have a fellow named Robert Mills with us. He was a lay friar, Franciscan brother. And he wanted to have the Salinas community, the Chinatown, which is a little bit like can be an encampment, but it's an encircled area, almost like at some point of occupied Vietnam back in old days. Yeah. It's a bit fortified in one-way systems, and it can be a really scary place or a very rich place, depending on how you look at it.
Right.
And the deep history of Chinatown was that it was the center of religious and cultural life for the Asian American community, which made it richer for everyone else because commerce was part of all this.
Sure.
So in the last years, Dorothy's Kitchen is there.
Right.
And CSUMB has stepped up, and they put in a learning center.
Oh.
And that's where I joined the picture back about 3 years ago. I got to be a bilingual computer trainer after I retired from my 30 years as an elementary school teacher here
in
California. So.
And the paper itself, what gave it life? When did this start? I see you're in the second edition or something.
Well, we're in our third
volume?
Year now. We started in December 2011.
Okay.
And a collective of homeless people and university people put together this collaboration, and the idea was to give voice to the marginalized, give a hand up instead of just a handout to the homeless.
Okay.
So they could find expression, they could learn marketable skills in terms of laying out newspapers, finding a way to get their poetry presented, the artistic expression, and also contribute to the dialogue, the social dialogue of how do we deal as a society with marginalized people. And what really excites me is the idea of equity in the arts. I don't think your artistic talent has too much to do with where you're born or how much money you've got, but it has a lot to do with opportunity. So creating opportunity, I think, is if I was to look back and say, did I ever have a vocation in this world? I think, yeah, maybe trying to organize to give people a chance to get involved in the arts.
Oh.
And here's the storytellers. The oral tradition is so rich, and the stratification of the homeless community where you still have hobos. I've had an incredible poet, Scott Burrows, who he rides trains, works, gets off. He has a very low opinion of people who stay someplace and are bums.
Okay.
In that by that ancient tradition of traveling, working people.
Sure.
And then there's this homeless community, and you talk to somebody like Mr. Tom Patton. He was a con man prior to his coming to Salinas after he got out of jail 18 years ago, 21 years ago. He's put together a novel of his adventures in the Western Caribbean and throughout the world.
No kidding.
But he's been living in the Chinatown for two decades now.
And is he also involved with the paper?
Very much so. He's our senior columnist for Nostalgia. He's he's a novelist, but he's also someone who's appeared in the Herald telling his story, where he was met up with Dennis Taylor, who does a lot of the Monday senior shows. Mm-hmm. So Tom's story as a senior was that he's really lived the life. He's a living lesson of if you're too greedy, you'll be sorry later.
Uh-huh.
And now he's sort of a warning the rest of us. Show that love for your family. Stay connected with the ones you love. And at the same time, he's finding communities every day to hook up with to give what he's got. And he's great raconteur, wonderful writer and a storyteller. Mm-hmm. Good style, great timing, and it's a pleasure to know.
And how did you get involved with the paper then, Michael? Did they seek you out, or was it something that you sought?
I stumbled over it. My contract as the bilingual teacher was not renewed in the learning center. They brought in a social worker to manage it, and they brought in CSUMB trainers.
Mm-hmm.
So I was just in that very interim period where the Cal State University had got the lab going and hadn't fully staffed it.
Okay.
So I was working with Anna. I was working with Megan Heath as a bilingual technology trainer, just before the big mobile tech lab got going.
Right.
So I was pioneering, but as things progressed, I was moved out.
Okay.
But I was still active and knew the folks.
Okay.
So when I heard about a chance to make a newspaper, this was too much fun.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you think back, I wasn't on the high school newspaper. I made the literary magazine.
Mm-hmm.
And then later, when I was at Trinity College in Dublin, I was on the Trinity College Miscellany, which has writers like Mr. Samuel Beckett, the Nobel Prize winner.
Yes.
So I'm assuming my Nobel Prize is in the mail should my opus and the quality of my writing improve radically and I get some good publicity.
Oh, please let us know, because we want you back on the show when you get that Nobel.
I think I might have to do something else to get back on the show.
Where can people find this paper then?
The paper is in, we get a lot of support from the downtown Salinas, the old town Salinas Center, so you'd find it at the Cherry Bean, the National Steinbeck Center. The Trish Sullivan's fantastic Forward Gallery, and these are the people who put on the first Fridays.
Right.
And Trish was good enough to have Mr. Tom Patton, our novelist, do his book signing there.
Oh, okay.
And again, you can also find it here downtown. We're trying to get distribution organized where the old Capitol Bookstore, the novel is available, and we're trying to get a regular supply in there where people can drop off a donation if they want to see a homeless paper keep going.
Mm-hmm.
And just see, we try to keep it light, interesting. We get some wonderful cartoons. Antonio Canalias is our regular cartoon contributor from downtown Managua, Nicaragua.
Hey, Jim, why don't we go to Houston? I think it is 07, because we'll pop that part of that up. That's the paper that people are seeing on the screen right there. And then, that's 07? Okay. Then maybe '08. Yeah, I know that's that. And I was looking for that comic, but I guess I missed it.
There we go.
There it is right there. Tell us about that. And what were you saying about the comic that people are seeing right now?
It reflects the time. This comic here was put together by Antonio Canalias, and he follows us on Facebook. He's an old friend of mine, and he's mentoring my son, Michael Tomas Houston, a graduate of Monterey High and now studying in Nicaragua. So he's a cartoonist and graphic artist in Nicaragua, and finding out about our sweeps and the national tendencies to try to make homeless people just plain old disappear.
Right.
As a rather impoverished artist living in a developing country, the fact that it would be illegal to look at the sky is sort of an extension of it's illegal to sleep in your car or sit down on the sidewalks, which are issues we are working out day by day.
Right. And what is it? Tell the name of the strip is
Cochoriados, the corked ones.
The corked ones?
And it's a rather existential term that you can sort of translate it as you wish.
Okay, all right. Because I love the name, but I couldn't figure out what the heck it meant.
Yeah.
How does this work then? I see there's a $1 donation, and does it go back to the homeless people? What's the deal?
It's basically we're educators.
Okay.
And our idea is as educators, that's part of free speech. So we wouldn't need a business license to share our information.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if we were selling something, well, you have to pay sales tax, and you have all this whole elaborate system going to you. But if someone sharing, as a great musician might, if you want to put a dollar in his or a $10 bill, and he graciously gives you a CD, that's quite generous, but that's separate from sales. What we're trying to do now is develop where our very anarchistic co-op, workers' co-op, where everybody has veto power, to a stage where we're going to be a viable business. Right now, we're working with sales reps, or representatives of the organization, who would look for places to take the paper. They would buy the paper and get a cut. They would buy it for a quarter, which is a very standard sort of policy.
Okay.
And then they'd keep the 75 cents when someone would be good enough to contribute. Now, they aren't for sale. You can just take them, of course.
Right.
And we are grateful to see people educate themselves. And we're still at developing our market. And it's a hard market. Should you look at street papers on Wikipedia, you get too hard in your crackpot social reality and reform, it's painful to read. If you're just call absorbed in yourself, you can find plenty of people doing that. So this particular issue, we visited with the people from Dublin, Ireland, and they have a magazine there called The Big Issue.
Right.
And they've reached a stage where they get about $4 for a copy. And if you sold that in your town, in a decent sized town, you could actually pay your rent and keep yourself off the streets, and yet, the homelessness story is one of what, our novelist is in and out of hotels. Sometimes he's hospitalized as his health falls down. So the model would be to create a real business. How we'll do that is not decided yet. We're going to be working on this in the next year as we continue the grants. We get some help with the Arts Council to train writers, to train poets, to get some books published. We're looking to publish bilingual anthologies of poetry, with amazing help from Lifeline has an award-winning translator, and on the translation service, and it's Sarita Chavez Cohen, and she is just gifted, and she helps us get our poetry published each time we put out a paper.
Okay.
So it's an interesting collaboration of people of goodwill. We're looking for people with more resources. Most of the people I know in the arts are not much good at business. There are wonderful exceptions. You've got the Chris Winfield in the Winfield Gallery that knows how to bring great art to people and knows how to sell it. A lot of the rest of us have trouble either making something decent or figuring out how to sell it. So it's an interesting existential situation all in all, where in the darkness of the night, are we really us at all? And what will we do next?
Michael, did you kiss the Blarney Stone? I mean, I've got.
I haven't been in Dublin since June, sure, but.
Okay, you know. But when you were there, you did, right?
Well, no, I didn't.
Well, we wish you the best with Voices of the Street. It's a wonderful, wonderful project, and you're bringing out the richness of that artistic fabric that's actually homeless and is not able to express itself. This is just very, very cool. I commend you for that. I respect you for that. I thank you for that, and so does the rest of the community. And we will be right back after taking this short break. My name's Steve Ellzey. I'm the executive producer for Access Monterey Peninsula. Stay tuned, though.
Just a moment with more of the Your Town television program here on AMP's cable channel 24 and on the internet at ampmedia.org. Just a moment with more of the Your Town television program here on AMP's cable channel 24 and on the internet at ampmedia.org.
Town television program. My name is Steve Ellzey. I'm the executive producer for Access Monterey Peninsula, and this is the Your Sanctuary Hour of the Your Town program, where we showcase the treasures, the pleasures, the wonders, and the resources of the Monterey County region. We certainly have one of the treasures right here with us, Michelle Lange, who is in charge of patron engagement, the director of patron engagement, I should say, and in charge of institutional advancement for the Monterey Symphony. Michelle, welcome to Your Town.
Thank you, Steve. It's great to be here.
And you just flew in from Phoenix?
I did.
Or Minnesota?
Well, sort of both, actually. Got stuck in Phoenix overnight, but that's okay.
Well, thank you. I know that the reason you came back was to be on my show, right?
I did, absolutely. Wouldn't have missed it, Steve.
Well, welcome. It's so nice to have you here, and we're going to obviously talk about the symphony. Mm-hmm. One of the things I didn't understand until a few years ago is, well, are there two Monterey symphonies? There's only one, right? But there's some confusion.
There is some confusion. There's actually the other symphony has changed their name to the Monterey County Pops. And so at one time it was the Monterey County Symphony, which is us,
right?
And then the Monterey Bay Symphony. Well, the Bay Symphony has changed their name to Monterey County Pops. So there are two different organizations, but they have two completely different missions, mm-hmm. and serve two completely different audiences.
Then tell us the mission of the Monterey Symphony.
Our mission is to engage, educate, and excite the people of our community through the continual performance and discovery of symphonic music.
Nice.
Thank you. I didn't really think about that one.
I enjoy being with you so much. This is a blast. Jim, could we go to Michelle 2? And this is just one of the photographs that we're showing, and it's, mm-hmm. A photograph of the symphony. Mm-hmm. Now, it used to be the Monterey County Symphony, but You're not funded by the county, right?
No, we're not. And our legal name still is Monterey County Symphony, but we just do business as Monterey Symphony. Mm-hmm. We receive no funding from the county.
And how do you get the funds? Because that's a big organization that you run.
It is. Our budget this year is between 1.8 and 1.9 million. And about 21% of that comes from ticket revenue.
Okay.
And the rest comes from individual contributions, foundation support, and then some earned income as well. Investment income.
Oh, wonderful.
Right. But the majority is from individual contributions.
Which shows how important the Monterey Symphony is to this area.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's a great figure. What? You have your performances mm-hmm. in two locations.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us why that is.
We perform in Sherwood Hall in Salinas,
okay.
and then at Sunset Center in Carmel. And we want to reach out to as many people as we can in Monterey County. And mm-hmm. so that is why we perform in both venues.
Mm-hmm.
Also, Sunset Center is a small, intimate venue, only 711 seats, and Sherwood Hall is much larger. So it does afford us opportunities to have larger groups to come in there. That's where we usually do our youth concerts every year, and we fill it with about 3,000 children.
Wow.
But just serving in two different locations is just to reach more people, really.
Now, Jim, if we could go to Michelle 3, please. How many members are there in the orchestra itself, or does that vary?
Well, the Monterey Symphony has about 65 contracted musicians.
Oh, okay.
But each performance will vary depending on what music we're performing.
Okay.
So each piece is written by the composer for so many different instruments. There
sure.
might be, 10 violins, 10 violas, and so on, So
mm-hmm.
We have to have that many people playing. So sometimes you might have a smaller, more intimate chamber
mm-hmm.
music setting, so not as many musicians on the stage at the same time.
Now, your performing season, or
mm-hmm.
the season, I don't know what the right word.
It's the season.
It's the season.
It is.
Tell us, how long is that? When does it start and end? And
our season starts in October and
mm-hmm.
goes through May, and we actually start this week. This is opening concert weekend.
Ooh.
So we will have performances six times this year,
mm-hmm.
October, November, and then we start back up February through May.
And the reason that you, is it a funding thing?
Yes, it is.
Okay.
Yes, it is. And we've fluctuated in the past. I think at one point the symphony, this is before my time here, was maybe at five concert sets per season, and then six and seven, and now we're back at six again for budgetary reasons.
Okay.
I mean, we would love to perform every month, every single weekend. Of course we would love that, but we need a lot more financial support.
Now, okay, tell us about your work in patron engagement. What is that?
Patron engagement is it's sort of a term for engaging your patrons, but
right.
through marketing. And
okay.
But more than that, it's also cultivating your patrons and getting them
mm-hmm.
to be repeat concert goers.
Mm-hmm.
Not just that one time coming to the concert, so coming back and engaging them in different ways. So in addition to the music, it might be all about the experience that they're having that evening.
Oh, okay.
There have been studies done, was it easy to park? Were you greeted when you entered the hall? Were you made to feel welcome? Different things like that. Did anybody follow up with you or say thank you for coming?
Mm-hmm.
So all of those things are engaging people to keep attending concerts.
And how about institutional advancement? Explain that to me.
Well, that's the money side of things, Steve.
Oh, okay.
Institutional advancement, that is
all
raising
right.
the money. Some orchestras would say director of development.
Mm-hmm.
There's probably a number of different terms for it.
So it is a common term
mm-hmm.
with symphonies is institutional advancement.
It is.
That's what they call it at NPS also.
Exactly.
So that was the first time I heard it, and I still didn't know what it meant when I heard it from over there. We're in Monterey. We're in Market 126. What is the difference, if there is any?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. Is there a difference between the Monterey Symphony
mm-hmm.
and, say, the San Jose Symphony?
They're probably fairly similar in size. San Jose may have a little bit larger budget,
uh-huh.
so they may have more performances.
Okay.
I know you had, had said maybe something like a Detroit Symphony, and that is a
right.
much larger
orchestra. Okay.
Much larger, much more robust season than we would have. So
mm-hmm.
That's the difference.
Okay.
Sometimes it's regional versus, for a whole entire state or something like that. So there are some differences, and it's all about the money and the number of performances.
But the quality of the performers is very similar.
Oh yes, exceptional.
You know,
it is. We draw musicians from, you know, from all over, mm-hmm. especially the California, the Bay Area. But we actually have one of our contracting musicians that comes every time we do a concert from Boston.
Wow. And I don't know why anyone would want to come to Monterey and perform classical music. But
well, I don't know.
Then again, Galiarskis.
Try to think of a few better things to do. I'm not sure what they would be, though.
Jim, if we could go to Michelle 4, 5, and 6 here. And Michelle, tell us about the October performance. It's coming up real soon.
It is. It's entitled Romance.
Okay.
And so it's the music of composers from the Romantic era.
Mm-hmm.
There's Wagner, Strauss, you know, so it's just really that music to maybe bring that special someone,
uh-huh.
enjoy the concert, make a great evening of it.
Okay. So the first performance is Romance, and it's on what day?
Friday night. It's Friday, October 18th
mm-hmm.
at 7:30 at Sherwood Hall in Salinas, and
okay.
then we're in Carmel Saturday evening at 8
mm-hmm.
and Sunday afternoon at 3 o'clock.
Okay. Now, I may have asked you this question some other time on a different show,
mm-hmm.
but Wagner
yes.
and Romance. And, you know, Jim, if you could just please bring up 7 and 8. Why Wagner with Romance?
Well, I think I shared with you before, you know, this is from an opera.
Right.
So the Lohengrin is the opera. And so this is the prelude to Act 3. And so what people may be more familiar with from this opera is the Wedding March. You know, so that is probably something that people would understand a little bit more. But this piece is equally beautiful.
Well, kind of like what we're showing on the screen over there, which is something from Lohengrin, right?
Very good.
Now, I want to ask you about the lover's point.
Mm-hmm.
I know romance, mm-hmm. lover's point,
mm-hmm.
but that's such a beautiful photograph.
Mm-hmm.
And did you take photographs then of other areas throughout the Central Coast for your other performances?
We did. We tried to tie the music that we're doing to our area, and
mm-hmm.
so that when people heard the music, they could think of something that they maybe were familiar with, such as Lover's Point, Romance.
Okay.
It just makes sense. And so that perhaps if you went to Lover's Point after the concert at another time, you might be reminded of that music.
Oh, great thinking.
Mm-hmm.
That's wonderful thinking.
Mm-hmm.
And let's talk about then the season as a whole.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us, you have passports because?
Mm-hmm. It's our season of discovery.
Okay.
And so we decided to give each person a passport this year to discover different things about classical music. We have our core audience who have been attending for many, many years.
All right.
But, you know, as is true with many symphony orchestras, our subscription audience, or that core audience, is declining.
Mm-hmm.
And so trying to find new ways to attract audience, and I understand for many people that they just don't really understand classical music.
Oh.
They don't know a lot about it. So we thought with this passport and helping you to discover classical music, it would make it more easy to understand, more enjoyable for you, and that you could relate it to things in your own life.
Now, coming up in November,
mm-hmm.
and Jim, if you could go to Michelle 09 and 10, I named the pictures after you.
Thank
by the
you.
Way. Could you tell that?
I could tell.
Okay. Vivaldi,
mm-hmm.
Four Seasons.
Mm-hmm.
What can we expect from the orchestra for this?
Well, I'm sure you can expect spectacular music.
Yes.
Christina Mock, who is our concertmaster, will
mm-hmm.
also be the featured soloist and the conductor for this piece.
Oh.
So it will be very interesting.
Now tell me, what does a concert master do?
The concert master is the first violin, and it's their responsibility. They come in and they, you know, tune the orchestra to make sure that everybody is ready when the maestro takes the podium.
Wow.
And, you know, and he also is kind of a leader. You know, we have the maestro conducting the orchestra, but the concert master is right in sync with him. And so, you know, some people may look to her as well, but she's just there to help out.
And then, so in November, Christina is going to conduct the orchestra
Yes, she will, while she's playing, yes. Mm-hmm.
Wait a minute, while she's playing?
Yes, so people will follow her lead.
Oh, I see.
Definitely.
All right. Okay, I was wondering how she was going to conduct the. Or I think of conducting doing this, and she's playing.
You can do it both ways.
I have no idea. I really should study up more.
Well,
when
I think,
do this
Steve,
interviews.
You did promise you're going to come to some of these concerts.
That's right,
this year, didn't you? I'm going to hold you to that.
And Vivaldi is waiting for
mm-hmm,
me.
It is.
Being as that's my favorite.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Well, you know, also in November, you know, I have to mention that we're doing a fully staged opera.
Oh, that's right.
A Mall in the Night Visitor. This is something, to my knowledge, the Monterey Symphony has never done a fully staged opera. So this is going to be really extraordinary. It's very family friendly, so mm-hmm. you know, it's the beginning of the holiday season, and it's just one of those timeless pieces that would be great for everybody to come and hear.
Then you say it's family friendly, mm-hmm. and I have, is it, it's an opera, it's sung in Italian?
No, it'll be in English.
So it is sung in English.
Mm-hmm.
So obviously everybody will know what the words mean, unless they're really, really big words and five syllables and stuff. And family friendly. Also, the story
very family friendly story. Mm-hmm.
Okay,
mm-hmm.
Boy, that's going to be terrific. Then, and we don't have time. We have a minute left. But in February you've got Innovations.
Mm-hmm.
I can't remember what March is. What's the theme for
Insight.
That? Insight and Inspiration is?
I think that's the next month, and then we're at Splendor in May.
Splendor
mm-hmm.
in May.
Mm-hmm.
What is the best way for people to find out more information or to buy tickets?
Well, you can go to MontereySymphony.org.
Okay.
Or you can call us at 646-8511.
Okay. And you still have the pre-concert lectures with Dr. Todd Samra?
Yes, we do. We 1 hour prior to each concert in the hall, we have a free lecture for everybody, and it really does make the listening experience more enjoyable because you understand a lot more about the music, the composer, the period of time. It really enhances your entire experience.
All right. Michelle, thanks so much for coming in and educating me and the audience about the Monterey Symphony. And we wish you the best. And
thanks.
Yes, there'll be an Ellzey,
mm-hmm.
and it will be me, in the audience. In
Bring
November.
A few friends along with you.
And okay, well, you know, I will.
Okay.
I promise. And I can think of one right now. But we want to thank you for watching also. This is the Your Town Television Program. My name is Steve Ellzey. I am your host today and every second Monday of the month. So keep watching, and thanks for tuning in to AMP Community Television.
Thank you very much for joining us today on the Your Town Television Program here on AMP's cable channel 24 and on the internet at ampmedia.org. Don't forget, the Your Town Television Program is on every weekday afternoon at 5 o'clock. For more information about the Your Town Television Program, go to our website, montereyradio.com. The Your Town Television Program is produced by Jim and Mary Lou Vossen under montereyradio.com. Thank you very much for joining us today.